Hello, everyone. Thank you for joining the webinar today on creative procedural workflows in MARI 4.7. My name is Elise, and I'm part of the field marketing team at Foundry, and it's my pleasure to introduce to you my colleague, Rory Whitford, and our guest speaker, Stuart Ansley. Rory will start off the session with some highlights of the latest release from MARI 4.7, and then Stuart will get into his custom procedural workflow. The session will end with a live Q&A, so if you have any questions for Stuart or Rory, please add them into the questions tab on the right-hand side. Also, so everybody is aware, Stuart's portion of the presentation has been pre-recorded for streaming quality purposes, but he is here to chat with us live, as you can see. So please feel free to chat throughout the presentation. Last year, we started our virtual events series, and we hosted over 50 webinars, all of which are available to watch on YouTube or LiveStorm. And this year, we're planning on bringing you more great content from the speakers you love. Your feedback is truly important to us when we're planning these events. So please take a moment to answer the poll questions today and to respond to the follow-up survey that we'll be sending after the webinar. Also, if you'd like to speak to a member of our team directly or join us on the virtual event stage, please feel free to reach out to us at virtual.events@foundry.com. Also, I'd like to take this opportunity to mention Foundry Learn. On Foundry Learn, you can find a dedicated hub for MARI, which has tutorials, release notes, developer documentation, and more. And here you can see a couple examples of the tutorials that we have available. And we're interested in knowing what other online learning resources you use, so please feel free to share those in the chat as well. And while you're on the Foundry website, I'd like to encourage you to check out the Insights Hub. On the Insights Hub, you can find some case studies and articles on industry trends, and also stay up to date with Foundry by following us on social media. You can find us either at Foundry Team or at the Foundry Team. And if you're an artist that likes to share their work on social media, I'd also encourage you to tag it with one of our made with hashtags, whether it's Nuke, MARI, or Modo. We love to share user-generated content, and it's a pleasure to see what you all are working on. So I'd definitely encourage you to do that. And finally, I'd like to thank everyone for their continued support. We made the most of an unexpected year in 2020. We partnered in 10 virtual events outside of Foundry. We hosted over 70 original webinars in 4 different languages, which featured 83 guest speakers from 39 different studios. And we reached 115 countries through our virtual event series. So thank you all for attending. You've inspired us to continue to bring more great content, and we're grateful for all of your support. So with that being said, I hope you enjoy today's webinar. Here's Rory and MARI 4.7.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to our first MARI webinar of the year. We had some great ones last year, so happy to keep the trend going. Just want to quickly touch on our latest release of MARI 4.7, came out in December, and just some of the kind of key features that came out with this release, which was a release we were working really hard at. We're really proud of some of the features that we got coming. Start off with the procedural mask workflow. So this is a sort of workflow which is built into the presentation that Stuart will have showing us there, which is the custom procedurals. And procedural masks is a way of rapidly blocking out your models, kind of masking your layers with using kind of custom procedurals, gizmos, the sort of tool sets workflows, using things like geochannels to have masks fit the form and shape of your object, so you can get things like dust and crevices, top-down snow on landscapes, that kind of thing, all inside a nicely packaged up file, which is easy to share. We also have the custom, the wider custom procedurals also supports color and scalar procedurals. So if you're doing, you want to kind of like little tools for doing wobble on a metal surface, or a kind of a combination of your favorite tiled procedurals all mixed together using a geochannel, this is where you would go for that. And these are all super easy to bundle together and share with the team. But Stuart will be diving into that much deeper in his presentation. So I'll jump across it quickly. 4.7 brings us our refresh shelf. We've kind of rebuilt the MARI shelf from the ground up to make it far easier to kind of manage and browse your library of tools and brushes, materials, images, etc. And it's also far more versatile. You can actually drag and drop images from your operating system browser, which you couldn't do before. And there are a bunch of filters you can use to kind of find all the exact tool you're after for the current task at hand. Moving on to our kind of big point to texture streaming workflows. This is kind of building on the work we did Mari 4.6v4, where we brought in the export on bake to the bake point. So if you're working in Mari and you have a bake point node, and in say Katana you've got a texture reshader, you can essentially get these two to read the same file on disk. So the bake point will write to disk, and Katana will read that file from disk. However, we had the problem that in Katana, some of the render vendors wouldn't support, say, EXR. You had to use a render vendor specific format, like TX for Arnold, TEX for RenderMan. So now we've added a post-process field in the bake point, so you can actually get the kind of the make text, the TX make command line run every time you update your bake point. So it kind of streams that data to Katana far more easily, and you don't have to go do a separate extra step. It can all be done in the background. We introduced material bake points, a big request since we introduced material system in 4.5. These are essentially bundled up bake points for each stream in the material system that you're using. So you can kind of batch edit and control the settings of your bake points and reduce the complexity of your very heavy material project much easier, kind of get on top of that performance. I think this is the final one. Yep. So the last one is material isolation. Now, this is my absolute favorite new feature in 4.7. What essentially, if you're working with a material system and you have a lot of different material types in your project, this essentially works like you would use the current layer or current paint target shader. It's now a current material shader where it'll use the material, the current material node or shader, and attach it to a full BXDF shader with light response for the entire material. It's kind of fill the entire object without having to change visibility settings and layers above your material or in the node graph. Even more powerful, any multi-channel node will now have a option when you hit the little one shortcut key to view its output to view the whole multi-channel node as a shader, and it kind of connects it all in. So it really makes when you're working with the multi-channel bake point or the material bake point together, you can have this kind of very cached project, which is kind of controlling the heaviness, but being able to go into each material, view it in isolation with the full response of the lighting, make your edits, and rebake the downstream bake points, and kind of streamline your whole material process. And that's pretty much it for the 4.7's highlights. From here, I'd like to quickly introduce Stuart Ansley, who will introduce himself a bit more detail in this video. So just say hi for now.
Hey, everybody. Thanks so much for joining us today. I hope that you learned some stuff about custom procedurals and nodes and how they work with layer stack and all this fun stuff. So yeah, stay tuned. Please ask a whole bunch of questions. I'm hopefully going to be able to answer some of them.
Thank you, Stuart. And with that, let's roll the tape and we'll see you guys afterwards.
Hey, everyone, Q&A. And welcome to this wonderful webinar for the latest release of Mari version 4.7 and one of its amazing features, custom procedurals. Today, we're going to be discussing what custom procedurals are, how to create, use, and share your very own custom procedurals, and some of the best practices when making custom procedurals to keep them efficient and user-friendly. I'll also be showing you some examples of tools that I use in production, which will be available for you to download after the presentation. Very quickly, let me just introduce myself. My name is Stuart Ansley. I'm a texture painter working at Digital Domain in Vancouver, British Columbia, Canada. I've been in the industry for about 7 years, and I got my start working at an indie animation and game studio. From there, I jumped to television for a couple of seasons, and for the past while, I've been working on feature films. Prior to my film work, I worked as a generalist for many years, and one thing that I really enjoyed was look development in V-Ray, Arnold, and Mental Ray back in the day. I spent a great deal of time in Maya's Hypershade, so node workflows have always been super interesting to me, which brought me into Mari's wonderful node graph system, which has a huge variety of nodes for you to get creative with procedural texturing. So I'm sure many of you attending are familiar with the concept of procedural texturing, but for anyone who hasn't heard that term before, what I mean is making use of things like random noises, tileable textures, adjustment filters, baked geometry maps like ambient occlusion and curvature, and other utilities to create interesting textures and masks. It's an efficient and quick way to cover your model with minimal or no hand painting, which keeps things non-destructive and easy to apply and iterate. A procedural tool is created by connecting a bunch of this stuff together in a network that either manipulates an incoming image like paint or a tileable image, or creating a result all on its own. Here are a couple of examples of assets that use some nice procedural texturing methods to add detail and breakup. This is a dust and dirt mask set up with AO as the main driver of the mask. And here are some edge wear and scratches that show up on the convex edges of this model. Mari 4.7 introduces a new feature called Custom Procedurals, which is a special type of group node to improve the reusability and shareability of your procedural texture node networks. Now, why is shareability important in this instance? So, let's say your coworker comes up to you and says, "Hey Dorothea, I made this really cool dust and dirt procedural texture template in Mari. You should really try it out on your next asset." And you say, "Wow, thanks Ricardo, that's very kind of you. I would love to use your dust and dirt template." And so you go into Ricardo's work directory and you find his node graph file and you get all excited and you load in the template and okay, wow, nothing is organized, connections everywhere, things are on top of other things, there are texture reference files missing, and you, this is a little bit crazy. And he's like, "Yeah, there's actually some really cool controls to edit with it. All you have to do is search for level 68 and HSV 34. They're a tiny bit buried, but I'm sure you can find them." And you're like, "Oh, wow, thanks so much." The reality of the situation is that as good as Ricardo's procedural dust and dirt mask might be, it's hardly useful if you have to spend a few hours digging through it to figure out how to use it, let alone edit it, and you still don't have any of the reference texture maps used in it. It would be easier to simply start from scratch. So as you can perhaps guess, there must be an easier way. In previous versions of Mari, you have two ways to share your procedural node networks, Gizmos and Mari Materials. Gizmos are simply group nodes that can be exported and saved to your hard drive and can be called into your node graph through the tab or right-click create menus. They can have as many inputs or outputs as you like and can be great for creating utilities or masks. Nodes grouped inside of the gizmo can have sliders, checkboxes, and numerical inputs exposed to be visible by highlighting the node properties of just the gizmo, which means instead of having to dive inside the group and dig for what you want to adjust, it's conveniently organized for you in an easy-to-reach spot. Mari Materials are the monolithic, multi-channel big brothers to gizmos. They live in your shelf and can be applied to either your node graph or layer stack, and they output preset textures for your material channels like base color, roughness, height, and so on. Just like gizmos, they can have exposed properties, easy to reach, and easy to adjust. There are some drawbacks to either system though. As robust as materials are, they're not overly malleable, and you're somewhat locked into the predetermined outputs. Gizmos are highly flexible and can be designed in any way you want, but they're not accessible in the shelf and they can't be used in the layer stack. And any texture files used in tiled, triplanar, or other nodes inside the gizmo will not be transferred along with the gizmo itself. Mari 4.7 introduces a middle sibling to the family with Custom Procedurals. Custom Procedurals offer all the flexibility of a gizmo, plus enhanced accessibility and a special package file format that bundles up and carries with it any referenced items like tileable texture files. Like materials, Custom Procedurals live in your shelf with a rendered or custom icon to give you a preview of its effect. Just like its siblings, Custom Procedurals have the ability to expose adjustable properties of its inner workings as well. Adding a custom procedural to your node graph is simple. Just drag it from your shelf and drop it where you want it to go and connect it to your network. They can be placed into a merge, into a mask input, or they can be placed in a network with information coming in to act like an adjustment filter. For our layer stack artists, the setup is simple too. Custom procedurals can be dragged and dropped into your layers as well, and you'll get a different reaction based on how these attributes, color, scalar, and mask, were set on the custom procedural's creation. With color selected, the custom procedural just gets added to the stack, either as a layer or an adjustment filter. Scalar procedurals will act the same way and sit happily in the layer stack on their own, but color management is turned off to preserve the linear information for your roughness, height, normal, or other raw data maps. If defined as a mask, the custom procedural can be dragged on top of a layer, material, or group and will automatically build a mask stack with that procedural mask as a base. Any tileable or reference texture maps included in the custom procedural is bundled together with the .mpc file, so no matter where you're working, you'll always have properly connected maps. No more red X's of sadness. So, how do we create our own awesome custom procedural? First things first, custom procedurals are always created in the node graph, so we've got to jump over there to get started. We can begin in two different ways. If you know you're going to be authoring a custom procedural, you can create a custom procedural node through the right-click or tab create menus, select it, and dive inside with a control double-click or control enter. Now, typically I'll be working away on an asset and creating procedural tools on the fly. So another way to do this is once you've done some work and made any sort of procedural network in your graph, select the series of nodes, hit Control G to group, and then convert to custom procedural. The next step is going to be promote any attributes you want the user to be able to quickly customize. Lastly, we'll define if this should be a color layer, scalar layer, or a mask. And we'll need a name and tags so we'll be able to quickly search for it and find it in the shelf. If we like, we can create a custom thumbnail, or we can let Mari provide a default shader ball thumbnail. Now we can save it to the hard drive or system network, and you or a team member can pick it up and import the package into your shelf, ready to use whenever you need it. I can open up my shelf, create a new tab for custom procedurals, import my collection, and they can live here for whenever I need them. If I feel I need to update one of them, I can tweak it, export it again, and then the item in the shelf updates as I overwrite the previous version. All right, enough of this training wheel stuff. Let's open up the throttle and see what we can really do with this thing. I've made a couple of examples, and these are all going to be available for you to download and play with as a free thank you for watching this webinar. So, welcome to your new VFX texture artist role. You're going to be working on the second season of a streaming episodic TV series. It's set in kind of medieval times, the heroes sort of hunt monsters and their magic and stuff, and the opening sequence is this big battle in a town, and you're going to have to build the environment. So, here's the opening shot of the series. Please excuse my storyboarding skills. They're not necessarily up to par, but hopefully you can see what I'm trying to represent. The camera is looking down at this cobblestone road. There are people running past the camera, splashing in puddles, fire is reflecting in the sky. The camera pans up to see this battle of epic proportions just beyond the buildings of the town. So your first task is to paint those cobblestones right at the head of the shot. Maybe not the most interesting thing, but you gotta start somewhere. We've got the camera locked in, the model is done, UVs are laid out and scaled for the camera, and we've got maybe about 5 or 10 minutes left in this webinar to finish this asset, so I think we'd better get started. Since we're a bit short on time, let's just see what we can do to get a rough first pass going. It's always good to plan ahead, so I'm going to make a few notes of things I want to hit right now. First, I want to get a tileable stone texture, but I want it to have a little bit of variety, little randomization, little scale shift. We can flip the textures around, and we should also add in a little random color shift here and there as well. Next, I see the edges of these bricks are all really smooth and CG. We should try and break the edges a bit, maybe break a few corners, chip some stone away a tiny bit. Then, once we've got the cobblestones looking nice, we've actually got another asset to take care of, and we're going to look at kind of an interesting tool to mix and blend different displacement maps together for this mysterious creature that the hero comes across in this episode. So let's start by randomizing these bricks a little bit. We're just looking at the diffuse channel right now, and I've got this ambient occlusion sitting on top so that you can actually see the shape of the geo a little bit better. From my shelf, I'm going to grab this tiled random custom procedural, and for this example, I'm just going to drop it into a layer stack. Right away, we see this warning, missing random ID. This is referring to a geo channel that this procedural needs for it to work correctly. I've actually already baked out the random ID map, and I've loaded it into my project, and all I have to do is convert it into a geo channel, either through the channel stack or using a bake point. And once we've done that, this should fix the warning message. And now that that's taken care of, we can look at these layer properties, and seeing what's there, it's kind of similar to a tiled procedural with a few extra options. So let's just start by dropping a generic stone texture on here and see what we get. We can play with the angle, position, scale, all that typical stuff. Below that, we also have some randomization options. There's also a control to change the overall scale of a random selection of bricks as well. We've got some flip-flop controls to flip the X or Y scale of random bricks. Lastly, there are some different base colors we can apply to random bricks. Each color is multiplied over a different set of bricks with different strengths, and some sets overlap each other, so you can get some cool variations. If we compare this to a regular tiled procedural, you can see that we have a lot more variety that we can get very quickly. Let's take a really quick glance at how this is created. I can select the tiled random custom procedural in my node graph and either control double click or control enter to jump inside. Now, this is going to look a little intimidating, and truth be told, opening up anybody's project file is often really confusing, but I've tried to label things as best as I can. I've left some sticky notes here and there to help anyone looking inside to understand a little bit better. We don't have a great deal of time during this webinar to go over the nitty-gritty of the inner workings of this, but like I said before, you're going to be able to download these for free afterwards and look over them in your own time. Just to quickly go over what we have here though, we have right smack dab in the center our basic tiled image, and then upstream of that are all the controls for randomly changing the UVs, and then to the right is the random color variation. In this section here, we've got the UVs right here, and they get multiplied and manipulated in different ways based on this random ID geo channel. Downstream, we have a couple of color nodes that get multiplied to the tiled image, and again, the random ID is used to create the mask where those colors are being added to. Just a really quick important note, if you've used Designer a lot, you may be wondering why all the scale and UV transformation stuff is happening before the tiled image and not after. So whereas in Designer, you would take your image and plug it into a transform node to manipulate its placement, Mari works a bit differently. In Mari, the placement controls all happen upstream of the image, which is the same way that Maya does it with a 2D placement node. All right, so we've got our color dialed in. I've jumped ahead a tiny bit and I've taken that tiled random custom procedural and I've set it up as a base inside of a material, using that as a source for some roughness and height information. Just to quickly show you how this is set up, let's have a look inside of the material in the node graph, jumping inside with control enter. Here is the same tiled random procedural as before with a little bit of an addition. We've got the out color like we did before, but I've also added this second out scaler output. All it's doing is taking the tiled image, but it's bypassing the color multipliers so that they don't get affected by the luminance of the image. And then I'm converting it to grayscale and linearizing it before sending it out. This is one of the really nice features of custom procedurals. If they don't do exactly what you need it to, it can be tweaked really easy to get what you're after. All right, so one thing I want to do is break these edges and corners up so that they're not so perfect. To do that, I'm going to jump over to my bump channel and I'm going to add a cloud noise and set it to multiply just to start digging into bricks randomly. Now, I got a mask in where I want to remove the chips and chunks from, so I can grab this bricks mask procedural and drag it right on top. Because this was published as a mask procedural, it will automatically create a mask stack on top of this layer. And as easy as that, we got some nice broken edges. Now, under the hood, this procedural runs off some curvature bake maps, with one of which that is very blurred, and with this mix slider here, we can control the tight and broad influence of this edge wear. There's a slot to input a custom tileable image to use as edgeware instead of a generic noise. And we have a couple more controls to tighten or broaden the edgeware to change its strength. And now we got it nice and dialed in. Let's again check out the inner workings of this procedural inside the node graph. Again, we're just going to go over this really quickly right now, and you can look a little bit closer with the free download package at your leisure after the presentation. We've got our two different curvature geo channels here, some noises, and some math. The edges essentially get their gamma remapped by the noise with this power node, which pulls and pushes the edges of the gradient in and out. The noise gets its value remapped with this linear node, with the upper limit set by the user. The same value is used to add contrast to the final output, crunching the mask like the jagged edges on the brick edgeware. And with that, we've got some nice edgeware on these bricks. So we've got a good start on these cobblestones. I think that we can now submit these to dailies for the supervisor to review. So let's have a look at this mysterious creature that we're going to be painting. All right, so here we got this horned creature, dude. A first pass sculpt has already been completed, but the client sent back some notes. They want to get a lot closer. They want to show it off in the show more, get a lot more hero shots of it, which means we need to add a lot more skin surface details. A great way to do this is by painting in displacement information captured from a real life scan of a model. A really nice new technique with these scans is getting a multi-channel displacement map with varying information in each of the channels. Red holds the general, somewhat broad level displacement, green holds smaller frequency bump information, and blue holds tiny surface details, giving the skin really nice breakup. It would be great if we could mix and blend the different channels together to get a more refined displacement map with all of the information combined. Using this multi-channel displacement mixer procedural, we can do just that. Let me do a really quick paint job on this guy using my multi-channel displacement map, just over this cheek region here. With this plugged into the bump channel of our shader, you can start to see some of the effect on the surface of the model, but something is missing, and I'll tell you what in just a second. I'm going to drag and drop this MCD mixer procedural above this on the layer stack, and instantly the bump changes. So, what's happened? By default, when converting images from RGB to scalar data, Mari, Nuke, and other software are just going to grab the red channel and use its luminance, which means we lose the green and blue channel information if we don't mix them together into a single grayscale map. This MCD mixer procedural takes the incoming RGB information, mixes the channels together, and spits out a single output. These sliders control how much of the different frequencies you want to blend together to fine-tune the result of the skin surface displacement. This is an example of a custom procedural that requires information either as an upstream node or a layer that the MCD mixer can sit on top of. This custom procedural acts like an adjustment filter, taking the incoming information, manipulating it, and then spitting out something new, much like a levels or HSV. With this, we can paint the multi-channel displacement information over the model and then use these sliders here to tweak the result, removing or adding different levels of detail to the map. Our assets are already starting to look really great, and with the rest of Mari's toolset, we can further refine the procedural stuff that we've built today into some AAA hero quality work. I hope I've shown you the power and customizability of custom procedurals. Using Mari's Node Graph toolset, we're able to create any type of tool we want and bundle it up into an efficient and shareable package to either use on our own separate projects, with other team members, or with other Mari users around the world. We looked at how we can create color, scalar, and mask procedurals and how to apply them to the layer stack and node graph scenes, and we've looked at how to add them to your shelf and grab them and use whenever you need them. Those three examples, the Tile Random, Brick Edgeware, and MCD Mixer, are just scratching the surface of what you can create with custom procedurals. I hope you found them intriguing and you'll grab the free downloads to play with after the presentation. Before we wrap up for the day, I just want to spend a minute going over a few best practices and some optimization tips when creating these custom procedurals. First off, keep it simple. The more complicated you get, the heavier the node will be in your scene. Also, keep the user controls simple. The more controls you add, the harder it will be for the user to understand how to use them. Bake and cache when your FPS drops. A lot of the time, creating heavy nodes is unavoidable, which results in a heavier load on your GPU, slowing down your frame per second, and can add to the spinning gray wheel of calculation frustration. If things start to chug, cache that layer or add a bake point to relieve the stress in your scene. You also have the added benefit of seeing the baked result rather than the unlimited resolution that procedural layers have. Mix and math nodes, the efficient cousins of merge nodes. They may be taken for granted, but merge nodes are quite powerful workhorse nodes with the ability to mix layers with different blend modes, swizzle outputs, and even do advanced blending based on luminance. All of those extra features can start to weigh down the merge node and can in turn slow down your scene if you have enough of them. A better alternative in the node graph is to use mixed nodes. This is one of the lightest nodes available, and all it does is blend from one input to the other using a value or a mask. If you want to multiply two nodes together, use a multiply node instead of a merge. The same goes for add and subtract. To blend the multiply result, plug the original image into mix A and the multiply into mix B and use the blend amount to control the multiply effect. This seems really small, but over the course of a project with 100 billion layers, it actually has a pretty big effect on performance. Node Graph versus Layer Stack. It's been said many times before, you can do a lot more with Node Graph than you can with the Layer Stack, and the same applies with these custom procedurals. Custom procedurals can have as many inputs or outputs as you want, but only one of each, the topmost, is accessible in the Layer Stack. If a custom procedural with multiple inputs and outputs is added to the Layer Stack, only the first input is connected to the incoming layer, and the first output is connected to the next layer. Lastly, ignore my first tip. Explore and get complicated. Who cares about the rules? Don't let me tell you what to do. Add as many things together as you can think of. Search for the limitations of the software on your own. You know your own requirements and the abilities of your hardware. I'm on a graphics card that was built in the Stone Age. Some of you are cruising on 3090 Titan RTX Double Shot Espresso Macchiato NVIDIA cards. You'll know way better than me how complex your procedural nodes can get before you experience slowdowns. Go out and explore and have fun with it. All right, thanks everyone for joining us today. I have some links and information here for you all to grab some free downloads off of my Gumroad. Just follow this link and look for the Mari Custom Procedural Examples product, and for the coupon code, type in Mari47Jan21. Please feel free to ask any questions you have about custom procedurals, Mari, NoGraph stuff, anything you like. If you want to follow up after the webinar as well, I'm often online on the Mari Discord, as well as Michael Wilde's Discord server, which I've included the links for as well. Thanks again for everyone for attending. I'm really looking forward to answering any of your questions.
Thank you very much, Stuart. Where are you? Come on stage.
There we go. All right, can you hear me?
Yes, excellent.
Went back, lovely. Okay, sweet.
That was absolutely brilliant, and I thank you very much, Stuart, for that presentation. I think you put that whole topic really well together in a very short amount of time.
Cool,
and
cool.
Yeah. And everyone who's watching, this is going to be recorded, so you can review his slides in close detail in later time. So with that, I think it's just about time to go to Q&A. So if anyone has any questions about anything Mari-related, custom procedurals, anything that Stuart touched on there, please ask in the questions tab, and we'll keep an eye on the chat. Also, if you guys want to know anything more about how to integrate Mari into your workflows, there is an email, virtual.events@foundry.com, where you should kind of send your questions, and our team of technical experts will be around to talk you guys through that stuff. I think there's a slide for that, as well as anything else to do with 4.7 you guys want to look into, deep dive into the new features. You can always find all that at foundry.com. So there's a couple of polls in the polls tab, if you guys want to check that out and give us your answers for those questions. And with that, I'd say we move on to Q&A. And once again, Stuart, thank you very much.
Cool.
All right. First of all, I'll ask you the question, which I'm sure your Gumroad will probably touch more, but where do you generate, or how do you generate those geo channels that you use in your various custom procedurals?
The random ID was done in ZBrush. You can use polygroup to polypaint, which is a really nice way to get random colors really quickly. You can also use Mari Motobakes, I think. And then you can also do Substance Painter and Mighty Bake. And there's a bunch of different ways to get random IDs, but I prefer ZBrush just because it's really, really fast.
Awesome. And your curvatures, et cetera.
Oh, yeah. Curvatures. Those are actually done with the curvature node inside of Mari. If you subdivide your mesh inside of Mari, you can get, because there's more points, you can get a really smooth result. And then you just blur it by a couple pixels, and it's really nice to work with.
Yeah, that's one of the techniques I use with myself. I use the curvature node, which is all hard and pasted. Then I use Mari's object generate Gaussian blur. Kind of get a nice point cloud, a point cloud based blur. And the nice thing about that is if you have like say a round pole on the ground, you'll get some of that that kind of white curvature from the pole onto your flat black ground spill over, because it kind of does it all in volume space, which is nice. Yeah.
And you can also use Mari Extension Pack also has like a multi-map bake output. So if you put in a curvature, it'll do like a curvature sharp, curvature blurred, curvature huge, curvature broad. It'll blur it for you really nicely, so you get a bunch of that stuff as well.
Thank you, Jens. Yes, I'm missing pictures of my wall. I'm working on that. We're going for a stark look.
I just got this white psych behind me, just like nothing, just all emptiness. Oh, it's back there.
Yeah, Livestorm doesn't have virtual backgrounds just yet.
I think so. Could be in space, yeah.
Much prefer being in space. It's always my best location. There was a question about... is there a license for academic version of Mari to download for students? And yes, there is. So for all students who are part of a student program, you can go to foundry.com/education. And let me just pop that into the chat. And this is where you can apply to get onto the education license for Foundry products. That was answered live, and I've lost the question. Great. That was life. Question about any updates regards to RenderMan. So RenderMan, pixel surface that comes, which works with Mari, actually is developed by the RenderMan team themselves. And you would need to go to the RenderMan forums and chat in there. I keep in contact with them periodically. I think they're all working on their next release of RenderMan at the moment. So probably now is a good time to check in with them and how they're going. And see what's cooking. Let's see. Alan Griffin asks a question about working with the textures XYZ. How do you get other multi-channel information projected with your bump? Wrapping, baking the mesh anyway? Curious if there's a plugin or method to project multiple textures.
Like you're talking about doing color and spec at the same time, as well as doing the displacement. If you want to do that way, you can use, I think it's called Z-Wrap in ZBrush is the best way that I know how to do that. To be honest, it's not as big of a deal as you want. If you really look at skin, the surface doesn't... you don't need to worry as much about getting the bump and the color lined up as much as you want. And if you are working that hero level, you're going to be working with an ICT scan, like the light projection scan of like a hero actor or something like that. And then you'll have a single map to kind of take care of that for you. And I think Z-Wrap is probably the best way that I know how to do it, but I'm sure there are other ways as well.
Yeah, I think Michael Wilde was doing an experiment with that, one of his projects, and one of the using a, I think it was Z-Wrap to get like a kind of the kind of a plane to wrap around an object. And one of the things you could do there is using Mari's text transfer, which is now fixed. It has been broken for many versions. We've finally fixed it in 4.7. Doesn't crash anymore or eat up all your RAM for breakfast. But one thing you could do is if you have a bunch of lined up images, you could essentially use a UV node on the plane and transfer those UVs onto your target object, which has the UVs across UDIMs, and then you could essentially use those that kind of baked paint layer of the UVs in 32 float space. Of course, maybe it wouldn't carry enough UV fidelity, but you can plug them to tile nodes of your color and your roughness, et cetera, but it's kind of a roundabout way to go. Basically, the bottom line, Mari doesn't currently have a multi-channel projection painting system. It's all only RGB, but that is one of the ways you could kind of work around that limitation. Otherwise, if you aren't worried about projection painting, if you just want to use multi-channel kind of masking in of procedurals, the material system does a pretty good job there, where you can essentially set up bunch of tile maps of various streams, and you just use a mask on the material layer to kind of bring that in where you need it. And question from Volker Troy. Is there some kind of Mari Moto bridge? Yes, there is. So if you go to the Moto tab, you can essentially get Mari to render, create a Moto project, LXO file, I believe, and kind of render, kind of export channels to a Moto shader and render those out, as well as using the Moto's baking engine, which is one of the ways that you can get curvatures and occlusions and any of Moto's shaders. There's a whole system for creating Moto-based presets that you can kind of bake out with the Moto renderer. It's not the fastest renderer, but it's definitely one that comes with Mari for free. Radio. While I'm looking for other questions, Stuart, what's your favorite part of the custom procedural workflow?
Well, it was funny when you guys asked me to do this. You were like, can you come do a presentation on this and talk about it? And I just kind of see this stuff as like a big sandbox for me to play in. And it was like, yeah, I can talk about playing with nodes and plugging in stuff and seeing what works. I was originally really inspired by the Campy 3D Jens's YouTube page, where he does a bunch of weird stuff like splicing the UV channel so that you can get what's it called? Like cutting down the middle of UVs to like a cutaway of stuff like that, and like doing weird things with nodes. And I was like, oh, that's really fun. So that kind of got me into just playing with node graph and plugging stuff in and breaking stuff until it worked. So that's my favorite thing.
I love your YouTube video about how to recreate warp nodes, like using the basic Mari standard nodes and math, and just warping using clouds and such to warp the UVs for tiles. It's great the way you broke that down.
Yeah, I want to kind of show people. It's not so much for me. It's not so much important to show people like this is how you do A, B, and C. It's more important for me to show you like you can do a lot of things with this. This is what I have experimented to do. I would love to see what you experiment to do with this as well. Like that's kind of what I want to get across a little bit.
Exactly. That's great. Question here. Is there going to be a location finder website to share custom procedures for Mari? So yes, we are working on that. There is an existing kind of Moto based sharing component to Mari's community. We're just working out the technical issues of getting it to work with Mari's kind of compound format. You can do it kind of manually where you kind of put up all the images and the descriptions yourself, but it'd be great. What we're trying to do is getting a web browser to be able to open up Mari and ask it what all the tags are and what the thumbnail is of the format. So we're working on that. Not sure on the timeline there, but we would like to get the kind of community sharing site working with Mari materials and custom procedurals. Michael's asking, what's your single favorite node, Stuart?
I think
what's your answer?
I like the scale node. I know that's a weird one, but I really like the way like color blending like that. I don't know why I really like you. It's just so intuitive for me to color blend that way. That's kind of a weird one, I know, but I like it. That's where my channel mixer kind of came from. That if you watched that video, it was like taking the scale node and doing a little bit more with it.
There's a question here about external normal maps. So basically the issue is when you reorientate them, they kind of break. Currently it's not something that Mari supports natively, but we are looking at doing that, upgrading the tiled and triplanar nodes to be able to reorient normals. But we have to first introduce kind of awareness to the image managers to like you kind of tag images and the image manager say, I'm scalar. We need to kind of tag an image, say, I'm normal data, so that Mari can then use that to reparameterize that. Not sure if that would work with projection painting, but yeah, it's definitely worth sending an email to support@foundry.com and making that as a feature request to bump it up the list of priorities that we have when we review features. So another question here is, can you version custom procedurals, if you have multiple artists, can you push out, change, retain older version? So I can answer this a bit. So there's no version control system in Mari. However, when you bring a custom procedural into Mari, it's kind of imported and it's part of the Mari project. But if you wanted to update it, you'd have to essentially delete the one that's there and bring it in. And we have various customers and studios who have kind of built their own version control systems around their own asset management systems to do just that. But if you guys wanted us to look at doing some kind of version control system, please send a feature request to support that. We're happy to review. Let's see what else is kicking around. Again, from old Mr. Grippin, how much of your workflow relies on custom gizmos, Stuart?
A whole lot. I love making my own procedural tools. A lot of the way that I work is kind of the way that I described it in the video, where I'll just be making something. And then at a certain point, I'll be like, oh, this is like kind of a cool, like I could use this dust, you know, map thing again. I'll just group it up and then ship it out and then reuse it in the next asset. I do that a lot with materials too. That's the beauty of the system is you make something once and then I don't want to have to make it for, if I'm making a car and I don't want to have to make car paint for the first asset and then car paint again and then car paint again and all this other stuff. So I'll make it once and then share it and use it as my base for the next time I do a car. And same with procedurals.
What shading model do you tend to use your material system works?
I keep it as simple as possible. I just use a BRDF material because it has the fewest outputs. And the more outputs, the more complicated it gets. And then you can plug it in to whatever shader you want. So I like using either an Unreal or an Arnold shader. So I'll just like take my channels and I'll just plug them. Even though it's a BRDF material, I'll plug it into an Unreal shader just because it's the same data. It's just being used on a different model.
Yeah, so that's definitely one of the methods I use. So even though Mari's material system kind of locks you to a shading model, it doesn't mean that you can't have multiple shading model targets. So you can essentially have a base color for a principal BRDF chain of materials, but then at the very end you could have a V-Ray or a Pixar surface, and if there's any additional adjustments you need to make to that data, you can do it at the very end of your node stack. So one of the things we're looking at doing this year is bringing the USD preview surface shader to Mari so that you could essentially have your VFX look of your asset as well as a preview look, because the principal BRDF versus the USD preview surface, they're very different shaders. So it's not something that's going to be very easy just translate. You kind of needs a bit of malleability and artist control to artistically judge the look of your preview surface. So have the ability to have like your channels that you're driving your principal BRDF or whatever it may be, and then that can target to Pixar surface for rendering and then use the preview surface. So you don't have to have all of your materials in both in Arnold and RenderMan and all the various render vendors. You can just keep them all one kind of lowest common denominator shading model and then just target it to different renderers at the end. Then there was a question here from Kelvin Tam, anything plans to speed up the height normal node? This is one for me. So it's really slow. Yes, and I can tell you why it is really slow. So unlike other texturing programs, Mari runs, Mari essentially builds a shader from all the kind of the nodes in the node tree or layers, and essentially compiles that to the GPU, and the GPU runs that per pixel on screen. So essentially, whenever you're looking at your canvas and there's a pixel on the model, Mari is essentially asking the GPU to render all of those nodes worth of operation data to kind of work out what the resolved color is of that pixel. And the more pixels on screen, the more times it's to do this. Now, with height as normal, this is a special kind of operation, because to be able to work out what the height differential is, it's actually sample neighboring texels of the material. So instead of just going through your material network once for a pixel, it's going to do it 3 to 5 times depending on what setting you have. So you're absolutely hammering the GPU to do that. So what other texturing packages do is they don't actually run live shaders. They bake them to texture maps, which essentially what you can do in Mari if you stick a bake point directly after your height is normal. So what you could do is, or even before your height is normal. So if you're doing a whole bunch of stuff with bumps and height, you can do all that, keep that live, and then the last thing you do is bake it to a bake point and then have a height is normal. Then your height is normal, all it's doing is sampling a texture map, which is much quicker on GPU than trying to run the entire shading, the entire gamut of shading operations. So hopefully it's essentially, it's nothing we can do to speed it up, but you can manage it by doing bake points or caching bumps and normal data. Stu, have you tried the material isolation feature in Mari yet?
No. It's for swapping between materials?
Yes.
I haven't. I haven't done a whole lot of... I've got 4.6 at work, so that's what I'm working on most of the time. And then when I'm at home, I haven't done a whole lot of material projects yet. Just been working on these custom procedural stuff right now. But I'm very excited to use it. I think on one of my next projects, I'm going to be diving into it a lot, which is going to be great.
How far do you kind of push your procedural workflows before you take over with projection painting?
The procedural workflow is going to be the base that's going to get you about 60 to 80% of the way done, and it's going to look good. It's going to look good when you are using a fully procedural workflow. I've done a whole bunch of stuff just inside of V-Ray with no painting at all, and it looks good. But if you want to have that like film quality, like get in there with the pixels and like you got to paint after that. It's going to take just as long to do that little 20% as it did for the 80%, but this is going to take it like this much better. So that's kind of my rule with that.
Here's a question for you from Andreas. Do you set up your asset with materials in Mari for more effective look dev, or do you go back and forth Mari and your renderer?
Yeah, definitely. I will do a first pass in Mari for to visualize the like the reflectivity of stuff. So how I work in Mari is generally I'd say most of the time, like 90% of the time, you're just looking at flat maps. You're not looking at a material all the time because it's more important for you to see like the values and the colors and things like that. Then to do a little bit of look dev inside of Mari so that you can actually get like a visual response of what the lighting is going to look like, I'll turn on the material and say, oh, you know, I'm a little bit off. I need this to be a little bit glossier or a little bit rougher or whatever. So I'll tweak it there. Then once I'm done that, I always publish out, look what it looks like in the renderer, whatever I'm using, V-Ray or Redshift or whatever, because there's going to be a discrepancy. And you can do either your look dev and tweaks in the render engine once you're happy with your maps, or if you're just doing it, if you're passing it off to somebody else, then you can go back into Mari and add like an HSV node, or like, it's kind of like mastering a song or something like that. You do your little production at first, and then you do like mixing. And then once you are comparing them back and forth, you're doing your mastering step, and then you publish it out, and then go from there.
A highly produced process.
Yeah. It always looks better the more steps you take, but it takes a lot longer and you do a lot more overtime. So, you know, that happens.
Which actually flows into this question about what light setup do you like to use when working Mari? Single lights, color, HDRI, grayscale, etc.
I use an HDRI, usually whatever I can find that the look dev artist is using is what I want to do, because that way I can compare as closely to what I'm going to see in my Mari scene to what they're going to see in their renders. I also like using different lights with some different colors on them as well, so that I can get more spec pings. But like I said, a lot of the time I'll do that for material setup. And then when I'm actually painting, I'm just painting flat diffuse channel or something like that, just flat lighting.
Excellent. And there was a question here from Emmy Lou. So, Stuart, are there any assets that you only use procedurals with, or is it something that you still hand paint everything at least a little bit?
Something is in the background. For the most part, I'll do hand painting on everything. If something needs to be really quickly done, I mean, if I'm working in Mari, I'll generally be there because I'm hand painting something. If I'm going to do work fully procedurally, I can probably just spit something out of either V-Ray or Designer or something like that. But if I'm working in Mari, it's because I want to use the projection tool set more than anything else. I hope that answers that.
Awesome. Well, I think we're pretty much done out of questions and out of time. So thank you once again, Stuart, very much for this webinar. I absolutely love it and can't wait to spread it amongst the interwebs for people to kind of get their heads around custom procedurals and use our new feature. And yeah, so thank you everybody for attending and thank you for your questions.
Yeah, thanks very much, everybody. Thanks so much.